See, in medical applications, these X-rays are normally used to detect the fracture of bones or breakage of bones or some problem related to the tooth or lung infections, especially in case of pneumonia or lung cancer, some problems related to the heart and breast cancer. So these are the different applications in case of medical. We have some other applications in manufacturing. So to detect the cracks of some metal joints or the head adhesion between the different materials, by using this X-ray, we can identify. So these X-rays are this type of radiation, so that can pass through the body in case of medical applications. So we cannot either sense this or we cannot see these X-rays. So as this X-ray pass through the body, the energy from this X-ray is absorbed at different rates by different parts of the body. Okay. So a detector on the other side of this body, so picks up these X-rays and they have passed through this and turns them into an image. So generally dense parts of your body, so that that X-rays, so find it more difficult to pass through, such as bones or some other white tissues, some mucus and all, right? So these are so difficult to pass, and it will show as a white color, right? And it will be more visible. So whereas the other parts where this X-ray are easily passed through, so that will, like your heart or lungs, right? So they will show as a darker areas, so we can easily identify. Okay, so on whiter parts, for example bones, if you see some whiter parts, you can easily identify the cracks or dislocations or some other things. Okay, the principle of this X-ray is very simple. So this is the basic X-ray. So it's having two. So this X-ray consists of a vacuum tube. So it consists of a cathode and an anode. It consists of a cathode and an anode. Okay. So where this cathode will emit this electron into this vacuum, and this anode will collect these electrons. And anode will collect these electrons and establishing a flow, so that is the electric current, so that is known as a beam. So electron from this cathode collide with this anode material. So this anode material is basically made with tungsten, molybdenum or copper. Okay, and so when it is collide with that, so it will accelerate into other electrons, such as electrons, ions and nuclei. So when this anode material, so only 1% of this, right, so only 1% of this energy gathered is emitted or this radiated. So usually perpendicular form. Okay, so where when it touches that, so only 1% of this energy is emitted or radiated. So these are this X-rays. Okay, so these X-rays, right, so usually emitted perpendicularly. So where we place an object here, okay, so where we place object here, and so in the other side, so where we have this X-ray detector, so that will detect and it will show based on your detection. Normally we have some analog X-rays are there and digital X-rays are there. In case of analog X-rays, so usually required a film. Okay, in case of digital X-rays, so where right, so that X-rays will captured by some solid state detectors. And after that, so that is converted to a digital image and we can see it on our screens. Okay, so where different types of X-rays are there, right? So one is film based X-rays and other one is the digital X-rays. Okay, so nowadays more or less we have this digital X-rays, are they? So this is the basic and we have this AEC, so that is automatic something like some automatic control is there. Okay, so that will detect the amount of radiation. So once that radiation is received, so after that so it will stop. So the thing is that, so where we need to concentrate on here, okay, So to develop this X-ray, it requires some high voltage DC current. High voltage DC current is required. So usually this voltage will vary from 20 to 150 kilovolts. So 20 to 150 kilovolts. And this voltage is appeared, or this voltage is given to this anode cathode. So you can see that. So this negative voltage is given to this cathode, and this positive voltage is given to the anode. Okay, so if it is 150 volts, so usually it will be operate like this. So this is plus 75 kV, and this one is minus 75 kV, and the difference is 150 kV. Okay, right. So generally, this negative voltage is given to the cathode, and this positive voltage is given to the anode. Okay, so this positive anode is made up of this materials like tungsten or molybdenum or copper. So generally, this anode, so whatever this rays that is coming from this anode, right? So that will be in bombard with this anode, okay, and releasing a lot of energy. So only 1% of that energy is generate the X-ray, and remaining energy is dissipated as a heat. Okay, remaining 1% of means remaining 99% of this energy is dissipated as heat. So generally, okay, so this much of energy so is dissipated across some small point of this anode. So what will happen, this anode or this material that used is tungsten, for example, so that will be melted. So therefore, what we have to do, they normally do is, so this anode is usually rotating. This anode usually rotating. So this is connected to this a motor drive. So usually we require a means induction machine, or we normally use a switched reluctance a motor. So this anode is usually rotating because this whatever the energy that is absorbed, what is that generated from the cathode, is to be absorbed by this anode. So if it is absorbed at a particular point, so the material that like tungsten, that material will be removed. So therefore, what we have to do is, this is anode is rotating at some speed, maybe if greater than 3000 rpm or something like that. So that depending on applications, we normally prefer an induction motor or a switched reluctance motor for this. Okay. The thing is that we need to apply so this much of voltage, and the current that involved so in this process is very small. So it is few milliamperes to some hundred milliamperes. So usually the current rating is in the order of one, somewhere around 100 milliampere current is usually required. And the exposure time is so usually very small. So this is only for 0.1 seconds. So the exposure time is very small. So that is only for 0.1 second. Okay. So this much energy, for example, if it is 150 kV and the current is 100 milliamperes, okay, and it is exposed to 1.1 seconds, so that much of energy, right? So it's 150 into this 100. So if you calculate, that means that is around 15 kilowatt, right? 15 kilowatt, correct? 150 kV and 100 milliamperes current. So that is roughly 15 kilowatt of power, right? Or this much of energy. So that is into 0.1. So this is the energy. So that is producing for a shorter duration of time. Okay. The current is very small, but the voltage of is in the order of 150 kV or like. So the time that is usually very small. So whatever the there are some other disadvantages with this X-ray are, especially you are exposing this X-rays for a longer duration. The thing is that it causes a cancer or other diseases. Okay. So you need to precisely control this voltage. You need to precisely control the voltage between this anode and cathode. So any deviation in this voltage, right, so any deviation in this voltage, the radiation changes. If there is change in this voltage, so automatically there is a change in the radiation. Okay, so that means you require some precise control. Say, especially these X-rays are harmful in case of the reproductive parts of the woman or some unborn child, in case of some children, especially in when you are doing X-ray for the lower abdomen. So therefore, some precision is required, and we need to exactly maintain this much of voltage, and that too, that voltage must be ripple free. So whenever there is ripples in the voltage, so obviously there is a means there is a change in the quality of the X-ray. So now the thing is that, so we need to obtain so high voltage from a single, usually the source is usually single phase 230 volt source. From 230 volts you need to obtain 150 kV, or from 400 or 415 volts you need to obtain so this 150 kV. So that is the object. So for this, so there are different ways are there. So one of the way is use an inverter, high frequency inverter, so which will generate the high frequency. After that, you need to connect a transformer with large turns ratio, a transformer with large turns ratio. Okay, so when you have large turns ratio on the secondary side, so it will produce a high voltage on the secondary, and that high voltage is used for some other, means for this X-ray application. Okay, the drawbacks with this large turns ratio is, one is the leakage inductance, right? So one is the leakage inductance. So why leakage inductance is more when your transformer having large number of turns? If it is large number of turns, the primary is having low number of turns and the secondary will be large, right? So that means there will be some leakage inductance in this case, and it will cause some leakage inductance. And the other one is when it is voltage is high, so there will be parasitic capacitance, so that exists between the turns to turn. There is a capacitor, so that exists between this turn to turn and all, right? So this is the parasitic capacitance is one drawback, and the presence of leakage inductance, that is another drawback if you increase the transformer turns ratio on the secondary side to obtain high voltage. So there are different circuits are there. So usually they are known as voltage multiplier circuits. They are known as voltage multiplier circuits. So for example, if you have a circuit like this, okay, so the source is E naught plus E sine omega t, right? So now the question is, so what is the steady state voltage across this capacitor or this VC infinite? What is the steady state voltage across this capacitor? The supply is E naught plus E sine omega t. So what is the steady state voltage? What's the steady state voltage? It's not just E naught, right? We already discussed that. So whenever there is no load, okay, when you are connected to capacitor across any source, the voltage across the capacitor under the steady state is its peak value. Okay, so what is the peak value for this? So this E naught plus E. Okay, so that means under steady state, this capacitor is charged to E naught plus E. So if you assume that, so there is no initial charge in the capacitor, that means the capacitor is uncharged. So in that case, under steady state, the voltage across this capacitor is E. So this is true for positive values. If this one, if E naught plus E is, if it is negative, so under this case, this diode will be reverse bias. Under this case, the voltage will be zero in case of negative voltages. Right. So during this diode forward bias, the capacitor is charged to the peak of the supply voltage, and it will be retained forever, right? And it will be retained forever, okay? As long as, so there is no path for the discharging. So even you are connected some, right? For example, some portion of this capacitors or some portion of this charge is discharged. And in other words, if the load is very small, so under this case, what will happen? This capacitor, some voltage, means the capacitor voltage will be slightly reduced. Okay, if you connect some load, so which is drawing relatively small amount of current, so what will happen under steady state or under normal condition, this capacitor voltage will be slightly reduced. But when you're operating in the positive off cycle or during, again, this during positive off cycle, again, this capacitor voltage will be recovered. Okay. So even though this charge is, even though the charge is slightly reduced due to the presence of load, but when you're operating again, when the subsequent positive off cycle, the capacitor will recover its energy. So that means under steady state, okay, so it will be maintained E naught plus E. So when the load current is small, okay, when the load current is small, right? If the load current is large, so what will happen? It requires a large capacitor to make this voltage constant, or sometimes what will happen, this capacitor voltage will be gradually changes. Okay. So that means it is maintaining a peak voltage, and at the same time, it is recovering its energy during the subsequent positive off cycles, even though it is drawing or even though it is losing some energy in the subsequent cycles, it is recovering its energy. So based on this principle, so we have some circuits. So these are, for example, we have a circuit like this. For example, this is E sin omega t. So what is the voltage across this VC1 and VC2? Under steady state, what is the voltage across this VC1 and what is the voltage across VC2? And there is no load. Under steady state, so what is the voltage across VC1 and VC2?
VC1 is E, sir. VC2 is 2E.
Yeah. So this VC1, right? So this is E. Okay. Now this will be plus and minus. Okay. So this will be plus and minus. So during positive off cycle, right, the current flow will be like this. And during the negative off cycle, so it will be like this, right? So during negative off cycle, so this diode will be forward biased. Okay. And this capacitor is charged to E on steady state, right? So during negative off cycle, sorry, during positive off cycle, we have two sources. So that is E plus sine omega t, right? So now this capacitor is charged to 2E. Is clear? Now the capacitor is charged to 2E. So during positive off cycle, so it is retaining, or during positive off cycle, it will maintain a voltage E. So negative off cycle, it will maintain a voltage E, and during positive off cycle, it will maintain a voltage 2E. So under steady state, so this will maintain a voltage E. So that means this plus negative, and this will maintain a voltage 2E. So there are two things are happening. So one thing is AC to DC conversion is happening. AC to DC conversion is happening. And the other thing is the voltage, this E value, right? So the voltage is multiplied by 2 times. The peak voltage is multiplied by 2 times on the output side. Okay. So this is a very popular circuit. So this circuit is known as circuit is known as off wave cockroach Walton circuit. So that's HWCW. So this was invented sometimes back in 1999. Okay. Since then, so this is very popular in applications like X-ray, in CRT tubes. In olden days, we have CRT tubes are used in televisions, right? And other some imaging applications, we normally use this cathode ray display tubes. Cathode ray tubes are used. For all these, you require high voltage. So that high voltage is generated by so these HWCW circuit. So this is simple circuit, so which will generate voltage multiplier circuit, which will generate twice the peak value of the supply voltage. So we have other circuits which will generate the triple the times this one. So the circuit will be like this. Yeah. Okay. So now tell me, what is the voltage across this capacitor? What is the voltage across this capacitor in the steady state?
E, sir.
E, right? And what is the voltage across this capacitor? What is the voltage across this capacitor?
2E.
This is 2E, right? And what is the voltage across this capacitor?
3E,
right? So this is the voltage tripler circuit. So this is the voltage tripler circuit. Okay. So earlier we have seen the voltage doubler circuit. So now we have seen this voltage tripler circuit. So we have also voltage quadruple circuit. Once again, the screen is freezed. Okay. 1, 2, 3. So this voltage quadruple circuit, so this capacitor, in this case this capacitor charged to E, so this is 2E and this is 3E and this is 4E, okay, right. So earlier we have seen the voltage doubler circuit, tripler circuit and the voltage quadruple circuit, okay. So that means, for example, this E is 100 volts, okay. So this will be 400 volts, so when ideally, so when there is no load, okay, right. So what is the drawback? So in this case of this quadruple circuits and all those, the main drawback is the rating of these diodes. In case of, if you use these quadruple circuits, so what is the reason is, so these diodes you need to block for this full voltage. In this case, it's supposed to block for 4E voltage, so this is block 3E voltage, and this is also block 3E voltage, and this is supposed to block this 2E voltage, okay. So that is the drawback. So when you are using the voltage tripler circuit, or for example this diode is supposed to block for 3E voltage, so whereas the previous one is supposed to block for only 2E voltage, so that is the drawback when you are using this tripler and the quadruple circuit. So therefore, instead of doing that, right, instead of going for other things, so what we have to do is we can cascade this one. So that means the output of the first one you can give it to the second one, and we are output of the second one we have to give it for the third one, so that we can obtain higher output voltage. So this is the same thing. So this is the voltage doubler circuit, so what we discussed, so both circuits are same, just they are redrawn. This is the first circuit, and we have this diode here. So both are same. So both circuits are same. So we have two capacitors. So this is one unit. So this is the first stage. So this each stage, this first stage, so output of the first stage is the input for the second stage, and so on. So this is the intermediate stage, and this is the nth stage. Okay. The intermediate stage, the input is this V in I. So we can see that this 2I plus 1. So for example, this I is 3. So that means this capacitor is C5 and this is C6. The first one capacitors are C1, C2, C2, C3, C4, and so on, Cn minus 1, C2n minus 1, and C2n. Okay, the output of the first one is connected to the second one, and output of the second one is connected to the third one, and so on. So ultimately, at the output side, you will get a high voltage. Okay, the output side, you will get high voltage. So for example, this is E sine omega t, okay, if you have n units are there, if you have n units are there, or n units are connected like this, so what should be the ideal output? So what should be the output voltage?
2n.
So what is the output voltage if you n units are there? It is n times the E, right? It is n times E. The output voltage ideally is n times the E. Okay. So these are known as voltage multiplier circuit. Okay. So these will work ideally. So this gives you voltage multiplication as long as there is no load. As long as there is no load. So this will give you, for example, at this intermediate stage, so this will give you 2E output or 3E output. Okay. Right. So as long as there is no load, so this will work fine. But in case if you are connected a load, or in case if you connect some load, so what will happen is, right, if you are connected load, so what is the resultant is voltage drop. Some voltage drop will occur. In this case, okay, so that voltage drop you can actually calculate So if you have stages, or this is one stick through this N, and this is nth stage, that means N are connected. Okay. So the actual output voltage ideally, so that means it is N into this peak to peak value, this AC supply, right? So this peak to peak value. So under non-ideal case, so when there is a load is present, so there will be some voltage drop. So that voltage drop can be written like this: some I load into 1 by I fs. Fs is the switching frequency, right? Switching frequency of this AC supply, into sigma n equal to 1 to n. So this n plus 1 minus I square divided by C2I minus 1 plus sigma I equal to 1 to n minus 1 n plus 1 minus I into n minus I C2I. Okay. So this derivation, so can be found from any of HVDC books, high voltage engineering books. Okay. So this is the voltage drop. So this voltage drop is depending on the load current. This is the total voltage drop. So it depends on the load current and the switching frequency. If the current is more, the drop will be more. And if the switching frequency is high, the drop will be less. Okay. And this is the capacitances, the voltage drop due to this different capacitances. So this is due to this C to this capacitance, and this is due to this capacitance. Okay. So this I is the any intermediate number. Since we are calculating the voltage drop from this to this stage, right? So we need to calculate for each stage voltage drop. Okay. You need to calculate the voltage drop for the each stage in this capacitor, and in the voltage drop in this this capacitor and this capacitor. Okay. Clear. So why there is this is only for N, right? This is only for N minus 1 because the output stage is voltage across this capacitor, right? So that means that last capacitor is not included. So therefore it is running from I equal to 1 to N minus 1 only. So this is the voltage drop. So if you assume that these capacitors are equal, for example, all these capacitors are equal. In every stage, we have two capacitors, right? That is C1, C2. So this is C1 and C2. If you assume that these all capacitors are same, that is C1, C2, up to C2N, we have 2N capacitors are there, right? Because it is N. So this 2N minus 1. And this is 2N. This is in first stage, and this is the capacitors in the last stage. If we assume that all these capacitors are same, all these capacitors are same. So under this condition, this delta V, this delta V naught, so it will be I load. So just we need to substitute these values. Okay. So it will be Fs into some C. If all these are equal to C, so it will be 2n cube by 3 plus n square by 2 minus n by 6. Okay. Right. So just we need to expand this one for each value of I. We need to expand this one. So for each value of I. And after that, we have some formulas are there. For example, it is varying for 1 by C plus 2 by C plus 3 by C and so on, right? We have the formula is N into N minus 1 by 2 into C, something like that we will write. Okay. In the same way, okay, by using this arithmetic additions, so the overall thing will be 2N cube by 3 plus N square by 2 minus N by 6. Okay. So this is the voltage drop that occur. So when this number of units are increases, if this N is increases, if N units or N stages are there, or this N is very large, so under this case, this voltage drop will be so very high. If the load current is high, so then all this voltage drop is high. If the capacitance is high, so under this case, this voltage drop will be less. Okay. And if you are operating at higher switching frequency, so that means the supply frequency, so this is actually a pulse one. So this is basically varying like this at higher switching frequency, usually in the order of 100 kilohertz or so. If this is high, so under this case also, the voltage drop will be very less. So this entire thing, right? So this is the V output. This is the ideal V output. So the practical one will be, that means this V out, this is the practical one. So this is difference, this means V out minus, that's ideal case, minus this drop. So that means this N into peak to peak value. Right, that means this peak value minus 1 by FSC into 2n cube by 3 plus n square by 2 minus n by 6. So that means this entire thing, so that's n peak to peak minus I load into 1 by FSC to 2n cube by 3 plus n square by 2 minus n by 6. So this is the overall output voltage. So this is the ideal one. So when there is no load, and this is the load, and this entire thing, right? So we can model as a, the entire thing, we can model as a resistor, right? So this entire thing, we can model as a loss-free resistor. So that means L, F, R, okay? So that means this entire thing, we can model as a resistor R naught. Okay. So that means this entire capacitance effect, so we are modeled as some resistance. So that means this were modeled as a voltage drop. Okay. So therefore, so this circuit or this equivalent circuit will be like this. So this is a two-port network. So this is the input for that. Okay. And we have this converter. And its no load gain, its no load gain is N, right? N into peak to peak value. So this is the output voltage. So this is the output voltage. And this is the model. So where we included the voltage drop. So where we included the voltage drop. So this is the R naught value. And this is the voltage drop here. And the remaining component or this voltage across this load is appeared here. So this is how we will model this. So this is the equation, right? So this is the voltage output. So this means overall output, this is V naught, right? So this V naught, so that means this is V output. So this is N times V peak to peak, right? So this is the one, right? So this I load, okay? So this I load can be written as V out. This I load can be written as V out by R load. Okay? This current is output voltage by this R load into this entire thing, 1 by FCC into 2n cube by 3 plus n square by 2 minus n by 6. Okay. So you have one side, we have V out, and the other side also we have this V out. Therefore, this V out can be calculated. So V out is, so this peak to peak value, okay, 6NFS CR load divided by 6FS CR load plus 4N cube plus 3N square minus N. So this is the overall output voltage, 6 pp into 6 nfs c into r load, 6 fs c r load plus 4 n square 3 n square minus n. So where n is the number of stages, fs is the switching frequency of the ac voltage, rl r load is the load resistance, and here c is the capacitance, right? So that means this capacitance value, we assume that all the capacitors are equal. Okay, we assume that all the capacitors are equal. So this is the output voltage expression. Okay. So ideal cases, right? So ideal cases, this value is proportional to N. So this output voltage in ideal case, so this is proportional to VPP. This is without load, and this is inclusion of load. That is the difference. If you plot these two curves, so it will be something like this. So we have this N, it is increasing order, and this is the voltage. So this is the V out. Okay. So this is the for ideal case. Okay. So this is for ideal case, and this is the voltage drop. Clear? This is voltage drop here on one side as a function of N, we're changing different values of N. So we are plotted for V out for ideal case, and this is the actual voltage drop. Okay, clear? So this is the point, so where we can have the minimum, or where we can have the maximum output voltage, right? So where we have this maximum output voltage, and this is the point, especially the output voltage and the voltage drop, so both are same. Okay, this is both are same, so that means the net output voltage are under non-ideal condition, so the output voltage is practically zero. Okay. Whatever the voltage drop is there, so the same amount of drop is appearing, so that means practically this value is zero, or overall output voltage is zero. Okay. So this is the point, so where we normally operate. Okay, so this is the point, so where we normally operate. So why this curve is like this? Because of this n square, we have this n cube relation is there, right? So because of that reason, the curve is having this shape. So this is the under the assumption that, so we have all the capacitors are equal. If this capacitors is also not equal, so we can expect some more drop in this voltage. So we can actually obtain some the maximum value of, so how much the maximum number of stages to obtain the maximum voltage, right? So we have this expression for the maximum voltage, right? This is the maximum output voltage. So if you want to calculate the number of turns, we need to derivate this one. So V out, differentiate this one in terms of zero. So differentiate this one in terms of zero. So that gives you the maximum output voltage. That gives you the maximum output voltage. So if you are differentiating this one, so you will get like this. So N square into 8N plus 3, 6FS C R load. So that is equal to zero. So you will get, so this relation, N square into 6N plus 3 minus 6FS C R load. So which is equal to zero. Clear? So this is the condition. So where you have maximum output voltage. So for these given parameters, either you can fix the maximum output voltage, or you can fix the you can fix the number of cells. So this is one drawback, is the reduction in output voltage or voltage drop. Another drawback is voltage ripple. That means the overall waveform will be something like this. Okay, so this is the ideal one. So that is N into PP. So whereas, so this is the V out, that is the practical one. So this one we are already calculated. So this is delta V. So now we need to calculate this delta V, or this sigma V, or this delta V. So we need to calculate this peak to peak ripple, and this is voltage drop. Clear? So when you have voltage drop, the radiation will be very less. When you have ripples in the output voltage or ripples, so in that case, so it will distort the image. That means the image quality or the X-ray quality will be distorted. So we have formula for this voltage ripple content. So that will be, this is the voltage ripple content. So I load into 1 by fs to sigma I 1 to n, n plus 1 minus I divided by c to I. Okay, so basically the ripples is due to this capacitance. The ripples are due to this capacitance. So if you expand this one, right, if you expand this one, so this I load by fs, expand this one, right, the first term, so if you assume that this is I, right, so that means if you expand this one, if you assume that this is 1 by C1 plus 2 by C2 plus 3 by C3 and so on up to N by Cn, if you assume that these capacitors, all these capacitors are same, and you're left with I load by Fs C, if you assume all are same, so 1 plus 2 plus 3 and so on, so this will be N into N plus 1 by 2, N into N plus 1 by 2. So this is the ripple content, so I load by Fc into N into N plus 1 by 2. So these are the things, right? So when you have connected several stages, this problem can be addressed. There are two drawbacks in this. The voltage drop will be very high, and we have some ripple content. So to address this one, so what we can do is, so like this, so what we have to do is, so we have single source is there. So this is DC. So where you'll get this high frequency AC, so which is usually operated at the frequency range of 100 to 200 kilohertz. Okay. So this entire thing, so we are divided into N by M times. So that means we have these three layers, for example, 1, 2, 3, and each one is divided like this. So that means it is N by, so each one consists of, so originally you require N, right? So that means each one will consist of N by M. So outputs are connected in series. Outputs are connected in series. And we have this transformer. So where we are providing the isolation for each stage. Right. So everything is same. So instead of connecting to a single source, right? So where you have some multiple sources are connected, this is connected to one source, this is connected to other source, this is connected to another source. Whatever the drop is there, right? Some drop of the portion. So we need to consider only this much of drop. That means we need to consider only n by m elements. So earlier we need to calculate the voltage drop for the n elements. Okay. So now we have these three are operating in the AC point of view. These are three are operating parallel. Means the source voltage point of view, these three are operating parallel, but the current point of view, these three are operating in series. Okay. So that means some of the voltage drop, these three are operating parallel, right? So that means means effectively it is operating with n by m stages. Okay. Effectively it is operating with n by m stages. So we can also calculate the voltage drop. So earlier we are calculated the voltage drop for this one, right? So this is the voltage drop expression. So this is the voltage drop expression. So if you want to do this one, so instead of this n, right, instead of this n, so this n is replaced by n by m. Okay. So this n is replaced with n by m. So now this is n by m units, right? So this is replaced with n by m. So that means the overall equation, when you're replacing this n with n by m and you're calculating the addition of all the three, so it will be 2n cube by 3m square plus n square by 3m plus or minus n by 6. So earlier we are connected six multiplier units, or sorry, n multiplier units. Okay. So what we have observed that, so there is a large voltage drop and voltage ripple is also very high. So therefore what we can do is we can divide this one into n by m units, right? So where each one is feeding or each section is feeding with a different source. Okay, so this is isolated here, all these things are isolated. So now this effect will be equal to operating n by m unit instead of n units. Okay, so therefore in that expression you need to substitute n by m in place of n. Okay, in place of n you need to substitute n by m. So this is the expression, so we obtained. So if you are calculating the output voltage in the similar way, right? You are calculating the output voltage in similar way. Output voltage calculated by, so how we are calculating the total input voltage? So that is n times peak to peak value minus, so this delta V, not right? Okay. And you can also replace this I load, so with V out by R load. So this I load can be replaced with V load by R load. So from this V out will be, so V is magnitude, that's V amplitude into 12nm square Fs CR load divided by 6m square Fs CR load plus 4n cube plus 3mn square minus m square n. Okay. No need to remember this. Okay. So this is V out expression. So where we have this amplitude. So that means it gives you the peak to peak value. Okay. So that gives you the peak to peak value. So this is the out expression for V out in case of this kind of arrangement. So we can also have the maximum, we can also have the maximum output, means maximum output voltage. We can differentiate this one. in with respect to n, with respect to n, we can differentiate this one. Okay. So this will be, if you differentiate this one, you'll get, or you can equate to zero. So this is n square, 8n plus 3m minus 6m square fs c r load, so which is equal to zero. So this is the condition for that. If you plot the previous thing, we have V voltage on output side and we have the other side, we are increasing the number of stages. So this is the for ideal case. If you have a single section, the output voltage may be like this. That means the voltage drop will be very high. So in case of multiple sections, right, in case of multiple section, so we can up, we can expect that, so there is some reduced voltage drop. Okay. If we are increasing this voltage sections, right, and here we have multiple voltage sections, so maybe the curve will be something like this. Okay. So where we are increasing the m. Clear? So we'll discuss more on the next class. If you have any questions, you have any questions?